Seattle Public Library for hosting tonight's program with Cathy Park Hong and Vince Schleitwiler. Cathy Park Hong is the author of three poetry collections, including Dance Dance Revolution, chosen by Adrienne Rich for the Barnard Women Poets Prize, and Engine Empire. Hong is a recipient of the Wyndham Campbell Literature Prize, a Guggenheim Fellowship, and a National Endowment for the Arts Fellowship. Her poems have been published in Poetry, the New York Times, the Paris Review, McSweeney's, Boston Review, and other journals. She's the poetry editor of the New Republic and a full professor at the Rutgers University Newark MFA program in poetry. And tonight she appears in conversation with a local scholar, critic, and journalist, Vince Schleitwiler, a fourth generation Japanese American. He was raised in Chicago's Rogers Park neighborhood and currently lives in Seattle. He's the author of Strange Fruit of the Black Pacific, Imperialism's Racial Justice and Its Fugitives. And this book explores the intersecting migrations of Japanese Americans, Filipinos, and African Americans across U.S. imperial domains. As a public scholar, he has collaborated with artist Ray Tajiri on Watari Dori, Birds of Passage. He served as a contributing writer and researcher for Japanese American Heritage on Vashon Island, and he's also a frequent contributor to Seattle's Pan-Asian American newspaper, the International Examiner. He's also quite a lively presence on Facebook, as Cathy Park Hong is on Twitter. So months ago, it actually seems like a lifetime ago, we were set to host this talk at Ellie Bay, and we started promoting this book in late December, early January, before the full effects of COVID-19 was even imagined in much of the world. And so much has happened since then, including waves of Black Lives Matter protests nationally and internationally, and also waves, unfortunately, of anti-Asian violence. In her book, Minor Feelings, An Asian American Reckoning, poet, critic, and essayist Cathy Park Hong wrote, "For as long as I could remember, I have struggled to prove myself into existence." For me, this line sets the tone for one of the most thoughtful and important books I've read in years. I had to stop for a minute and think about it. Much of this book is like that, lines that you could pass by, but you can't because you know that you're going to recognize something here that is percolating away in yourself and within our communities, and this recognition is powerful. In this book, she raised something within us as a community, and there's no turning back, and she might be writing about the uncertainty of Asian Americanness as an identity or as a people, or about the revolutionary comedy of Richard Pryor, or of the unknown life of Teresa Hawk Kyung Cha, and she's one of the foremothers of Asian American avant-garde writing, and it was really wonderful to see more details about her life in this book. All this year I've been saying this book woke me up, and now I have to say I have to live up to it. Reading it was a life-changing experience for me, and I think it will be for you too. And speaking of that, there's been a bit of time, so I'm thinking that some of you may have read this book. You may also have questions raised by the Q&A. We're going to try to get to as many questions as possible, and we would like you to enter those questions in the Q&A function. But with that, please join me and welcoming Cathy Park Hong and Vince Schleitwiler to this virtual Seattle Public Library event.
Thank you, Karen, and thanks to Stesha and Karen for really keeping the faith with this event that was really a long time coming. And I want to add, part of what makes it a long time coming, Cathy, as you know, is that our paths kind of crossed quite a bit in our lives. We've never really had a chance to sit down and talk, but the two of us both overlapped at Oberlin College. We were both in New York after that, and I didn't realize that, I can't remember if we, I don't think we overlapped at the Village Voice, but I think we're both at the Village Voice at some point. Anyway, and we've encountered each other through the years, but we were supposed to talk in March, and then, things happened. I was actually scheduled to teach this book in a class in the spring quarter, and it was scheduled for the last week of the quarter. And then they burned down the precinct in Minneapolis. And so we did didn't talk about this book, we talked things. So I'm really, really excited finally to have this conversation. And, you know, I was thinking, I wanted to start actually talking about how the world has changed. Because I think not only did the pandemic reveal or expose a lot of anti-Asian racism that has always been in U.S. culture and never gone away, but I also think that the George Floyd protests even more so have caused Asian Americans to try to understand our place in a U.S. racial order in a different way. And that kind of reckoning, right, I don't think has anything comparable with it since the 60s when the term Asian American was invented. So you wrote a book that is really resonant with these questions, but you wrote it before, right? And I imagine that that's an experience of a kind of intense vertigo, right? To see the world playing out in ways that are clearly resonating with your book after the book's already out there. So I was wondering if you wanted to talk a little bit about how you have thought about these events, how you felt about these events, and the relationship of your book to them.
Yeah, sure, thank you. That's a really thoughtful question. And speak on that. I want to thank Karen. Thank you so much for your really moving introduction. I'm really happy that this is finally happening, you know, in a virtual form. I'd rather do this IRL, but, you know, c'est la vie. And Vince, it's really exciting to be talking to you. We are Oberlin alums. Oberlin is featured in my book, Minor Feelings. And I think we've always had friends in common. I think we were in a group together, some kind of club or something. Asian American. You were the head. You were like, you were the president of this group, right?
We had this experimental college. I don't remember this. Student-run classes. And they were essentially just excuses to get a discounted beer, right? This night where instructors get a beer. And so I ran this really shameful excuse of an Asian American literature or arts class. And I think you were part of it. And I remember thinking like, oh, there are these people who are really, you know, they have these serious questions. And I was just looking for cheap beer.
I don't remember that at all. I thought I was a total slacker. But do you remember? I think that's like my memory of you, leading the Exco. And I was also thinking that you were very serious and scholarly too. So, you know, but I, anyway, I'm really excited to be here. How do I answer this question? I mean, it's been really, a vertigo to see this book, Minor Feelings, come out during this kind of political hurricane. If I were to know that this book was going to come out during this time period, pandemic and George Floyd, what happened to George Floyd and everything else, I would have thought that the book would have just gotten lost in the maelstrom. And I've been really heartened to hear how the book has actually been a kind of has been sort of a guiding light, one of many guiding lights for Asian Americans, and that has been really, really, really gratifying. I've been told that the book is quite timely from a number of people, and timeliness is a description that I, you know, approach warily because, you know, race is always timely. But I would say even I was not expecting the anti-Asian racism. We East Asians, and here I must be specific about not South Asians, but East Asians are used to being hyper invisible rather than hyper visible. And to see us as a target the way Muslims were during 9/11 was indeed very much, it took some getting used to. That being said, you know, I've been saying this over and over again, and many other critics have said this before, you know, anti-Asian, everything that's the xenophobia, yellow peril, you know, being called chink, that was always under the surface, you know, I mean, and we have many historical moments from the Exclusion Act to what was happening, you know, what happened to Japanese Americans in the 80s. I mean, it was always there. It was always percolating. And I just feel like, you know, with the US, it's like with, BIPOC, BIPOC, but I guess more non-white immigrants, it's like musical chairs, you know, it's like what group is going to be the scapegoat based on what's happening economically or foreign policy. And I guess this time it was the East Asian Americans' turn. What I really feel excited about is how, and maybe this is just the people who I tend to be in contact with, how Asian Americans have been galvanized and are really doing as much as they can to ally themselves with Black Lives Matter and really being active protesters. And it does really feel exciting to me that I'm seeing echoes of kind of the marchers, you know, the protesters in the late 60s and 70s when a lot of Asian American activists allied themselves with the Black Power movement. And there was like also Third World power as well. And a lot of that coming from the Bay Area. So all of that, I mean, there's like so many things to say about it. One thing I will say though, is that when I was writing the book, this was happening while I was writing the book. Like I started writing the book in 2015. Black Lives Matter was happening in November 2014. That's when it started. So it was like while I was working on this book, you know, you had the Black Lives Matter uprising and there were protests, university campuses and the arts, education everywhere. I mean, it was all percolating and I was seeing this activism incubating in my classroom as well, where, my students are poets, you know, and I was really seeing this energy where like, say like 10, 15 years ago, the poets in my class, you know, or when I was a grad student, the poets didn't want politics in the classroom at all, or didn't want to talk about race at all. Whereas especially within the last 5 years, the poets really considered themselves activists. And so it was all kind of, it was percolating, it was incubating, and then it just blew up, you know? So as heartened I am, I'm not entirely surprised. I'm actually really happy. I was like, when is the revolution gonna happen? And it's not happening. I mean, of course, it's also really scary, but that's my long-winded response. And I don't know if I answered your question.
No, that's great. And I want to get back in maybe in a question or two to that earlier period, because I think it's important, right? And I think that, you know, those of us who've been following the poetry world know that there was a kind of reckoning that began then that you were part of. And so it's interesting now to look back on it or to look at a new wave of it. I think there's something underneath there that was happening with, maybe I'll go ahead and ask this question now, right? Coming up in an era of multiculturalism, right? In an era when multiculturalism went from this kind of insurgent force that was, came out of what was left of those older third world movements, right? And became really a kind of dominant language for talking about difference in a time of unquestioned US power. And we dealt with the politics of that, at a time that was probably, you know, as reactionary a period in American culture as you can find going back 100 years. And that's what started to break down, right, a few years back. And so, and yet, there's this tremendous change now, right? I mean, the students, I'm teaching a class now that I taught in the winter, and the students, it's like they took a couple years of graduate school and ethnic studies in between, right? I was teaching a class in Asian American theater and performance right before the George Floyd protest, taught the same class in the beginning of the summer, again, completely different students, right? And so I'm kind of curious, as somebody who you know, was very, very involved with teaching poets, with younger poets, but also in participating in this kind of reckoning about race that the poetry world had a few years back, what is it like to see this new wave of it and to see new challenges coming from folks who kind of taking that for granted?
I think that's a very good question. You were breaking up in the middle, in the very beginning here. You were saying something about multiculturalism. What period of time were you talking about?
Yeah, so I think, multiculturalism coming out of the 1980s really by the time we're in college, right, that's when it becomes dominant.
Yeah.
And we don't notice that because we think we're still fighting. And also because Oberlin, like a lot of liberal arts colleges, is generally 10 to 20 years behind the times anyway, right? But it became dominant and we didn't know that, right? And that is language we have talked about. Mm-hmm. Right? The other thing that's happening is the U.S. empire is a race and power change. Sorry, that's very zooming out, very big picture. Like I said, I was kind of curious though about your experience though, because again, I don't know how much people here in the audience were sort of following those debates in the poetry world, but the reckoning began in poetry earlier than this year. Yeah.
I mean, are you talking about? I mean, it was happening in the arts, you know, definitely poetry. It was happening in visual arts as well. And what is happening, you know, it's funny, like, I have to talk about Oberlin since you went to Oberlin too. And, you know, Oberlin is always made fun of by the press for being overly PC and just getting really pissed off about how bad the banh mi sandwiches are in cafeterias and so forth. And they're always like kind of dubbed as being overly entitled and so forth. But the kind of overly politically correct culture has never changes at Oberlin. And it was the same way when we were in school. But in a way, it's like I was not, you know, none of what's happening now, you know, with woke culture or cancel culture or whatever. That's what I grew up with, you know, that was like Oberlin, you know? And so it's like, but I do think that like kind of racial discourse goes in waves, you know? So, you know, Claudia Rankine has talked about it. She's like, we're only, you know, in the anthology that she edited, she talked about how Americans really only understand, can only talk about race when it's a scandal. And they have a hard time considering it, talking about it as like a chronic condition, something that actually is not changing and is the bedrock of this country. I quoted Kirgita Sharma in Minor Feelings, where white Americans treat race like they do, like they treat grief. At some point, they expect you to get over it. And I think politically, you know, and I think you've seen that wave, you know, you have like this wave of multiculturalism in the 80s. And then it just died. And then by the time I was in grad school, by the time I was like living in New York, no one wanted to talk about it, you know, and there was like post-race America, there was Obama, there was also the poetry world was really apolitical, very white, which I write about in stand-up. And then there was again sort of a reckoning, I would say, with Black Lives Matter. But I also think, you know, within the last 5 years, there's also been a lot of thinkers who've been, and I feel like we can't discount them enough, like Nicole Hannah-Jones and Ta-Nehisi Coates and Claudia Rankine and, you know, Kiese Layman and all of these writers and activists and so forth who've been like really doing the work. And the fact that you have like, you know, some stay-at-home mom from white woman from Wyoming talking about structural racism, that was not happening like 5 years ago. So I think that there's like, this movement is only growing. We also have to realize, I mean, I also think that like, this is also bound to happen, Linda. I mean, 2015, I mean, so 2050, minorities will be the majority. And so we're seeing that and like, well, and we're going to see more of that, like with global warming, what's going to happen to with climate refugees? Are we going to, if we build a wall, millions will die in Guatemala and so forth. So it's like, there's also kind of this global reckoning that's gonna happen where the formerly colonized are going to come into the West. They're going to, like, you know, they're going to swarm the West. And this is like a, you know, someone, some xenophobe's perspective. So what's America going to be? What is race going to be? And this is something that I was, like, really thinking about in Minor Feelings, like, you know, Asian Americans are going to be double what they are now. We may now be, like, such a small percentage that we don't even register in the polls, that we're still considered other. But we are a growing demographic, and it cannot be ignored, nor will other non-whites. And even though we have to center Black voices, Indigenous voices, we also have to consider, well, what's going to happen with these other immigrants? And we also have to consider America's racism abroad, you know, with, say, the Chinese Exclusion Act, the Japanese internment, what they did to South America, and all of it. Like, there's a lot of reckonings America needs to deal with. And we have to be as precise as possible in our activism.
That's excellent. I wanted to make sure I got in a question about the concept of minor feelings, right, and ask you to talk about that. You mentioned earlier in your last comment, you were talking about what I think Rita Sharma's about grief, right? And it made me think about a line that James Baldwin says, where he says, white Americans don't believe in death, and that's why the color of my skin makes them afraid. There's something really complicated that you're trying to get in that concept of minor feelings. And I just wanted to start by saying, you know, for most non-Asian American audiences, right, introducing these kind of ideas, you talk about, you have to work with stereotypes of passivity or submissiveness or emotionlessness of Asian Americans, Asian American women. I'd like to think that the Elliott Bay Seattle Public Library audience is one that is a little bit more informed in Asian American and Asian American feminist students, right? Where the obvious thing that people talk about is actually anger and rage, right? And there's a lot of anger and rage in this book too, right? But there's a point that you're making about minor feelings that I think is really complex and new. And I was wondering if you could just have a little bit of that.
If I want to talk
yeah.
about my feelings,
yeah.
but I mean, I'm wondering if it's better if I just, like, read it, read a passage, because
sure.
I feel like every time I try to define it, I'm like, yeah. I wrote about it. I should be able to define it. Because I think it is a kind of slippery term, and I'm like, I don't even know. And then I'll talk about it afterwards. But my book does a better job defining it than I do extemporaneously. Okay, so I'll just read just a couple paragraphs. This is when I talk about Richard Pryor. In Pryor, I saw someone channel what I call minor feelings, a racialized range of emotions that are negative, dysphoric, and therefore unintelligent, built from the sediments of everyday racial experience and the irritant of having one's perception of reality constantly questioned or dismissed. Minor feelings arise, for instance, upon hearing a slight, knowing it's racial, and being told, oh, that's all in your head. You know, a classic book that explores minor feelings is Claudia Rankine's Citizen. After hearing a racist remark, the speaker asked herself, what did you say? She saw what she saw, she heard what she heard, but after her reality has been belittled so many times, she begins to doubt her very own senses. Such disfiguring of senses engenders minor feelings of paranoia, shame, irritation, and melancholy. Minor feelings are not often featured in contemporary American literature because these emotions do not conform to the archetypal narrative that highlights survival and self-determination. Unlike the organizing principles of a Bildungsroman, minor feelings are not generated from major change, but from lack of change, in particular structural, racial, and economic change. Rather than using racial trauma as a dramatic stage for individual growth, the literature of minor feelings explores the trauma of a racist capitalist system that keeps the individual in place. So I want to stop right there, because I think that's, like, a key kind of characteristic of what minor feelings is that sort of the kind of feelings that are generated when it, you know, in a system that doesn't actually change your position, you know, and I think it's actually getting worse where as the pandemic has indicated, where we're going from like a neoliberal country to a neo-feudal country. I'm really curious about this book that's coming out. I think her name is, what's her name? Isabel Wilkinson? Wilkinson, mm-hmm. She wrote a book called Caste, you know, and it's something that is as, where race and class are just so sedimented, so built in, and it just, and yet we still have this sort of mentality, you know, we're still fed this sort of American optimism. And so it's this kind of, I guess it's this kind of feeling where you are stuck, you know, whether you're Indigenous or Black or like you're Chinese American or whatever, but then at the same time, your reality of being stuck is constantly gaslit, you know, by the dominant culture, who believes that really believes so wholeheartedly in individual triumph, and that it you know, and this kind of really believes so wholeheartedly in individual freedom for the sake of any kind of collective, for the sake of any kind of collective sacrifice, and what that does to you mentally. And I think it's also my idea of minor feelings has a lot to do with this Korean, which I talk about in the book, this national emotion called Han, which is a combination of melancholy and paranoia and shame and, you know, minor feelings, that has to do with Korea's own history of colonization and war and dictatorships and so forth. And I was like, well, this is something that, and I'm like, Han is what I really relate to. But why is it, and I don't think it's just a Korean phenomenon. It's something that could be also translated in American soil too. And I do think, though I'm wary of analogizing, making analogies between different races, I do think there are some parallels between Korean Han and then also the Black condition in America. You know?
Thanks for that. I know that there are a bunch of questions piling up. We're going to go to questions to the Q&A soon and get through as many of those as we can. I have so many questions that I did not get to, we'll see what we can do. But one thing I did want to actually ask you about, one more question before we go to Q&A. At the end of your book, you talk about Yuri Kochiyama. Did you meet Yuri at Orland?
What? Did I meet Yuri?
Did you meet Yuri? Yeah.
No. Was she? Wait.
Yuri came to Oberlin, and it was I was actually on the London program that you went on when she came. My wife, all my friends, they all met her. My aunt made a movie about her. Anyway, Yuri Kochiyama, a great Japanese American activist, who is famous for her work with Malcolm X, with Puerto Rican nationalists. You talk also about, you end by talking about the protest at Fort Sill, Oklahoma by Sudo for Solidarity. And you quote actually Tom Ikeda. I don't know if you know Tom Ikeda, the head of Densho, somebody a lot of folks here in Seattle know really well. Talking about solidarity, right? And so I guess the question that I want to the last question I want to ask for the Q&A is, you know, thinking about this problem of solidarity, right? In your, in that essay, you talk about a lot of things that are very specifically Korean American, right? And what is the sort of, meaning of a term like Asian American in that context? And then how do you take that sense of solidarity and extend it to, to questions of anti-Blackness, to questions of settler colonialism, at a time when that solidarity is really very, very questionable? You have, thoughts about how you feel those acts of solidarity can hold up?
No, I think it's a really complicated question. I do believe in solidarity. I do believe in allyship. I think that as much as it's important to talk about how racial capitalism where the different slots we're in because of racial capitalism and how my oppression is nothing like your oppression. It's also important to talk about how we are connected too, because I think in order to really just tear the house down, you know, and tear the rotten plumbing down, we need to band together. Easier said than done. But I think that, you know, when I talk about, I'm very wary about how social media and digital capitalism puts us into these, like, you know, it's like branding. I think it's an extension of branding where you're like, this is my territory, this is my spot, you know, this is my identity, and you're over there and I'm over there. And I think it creates what Hannah Arendt calls mega solidarity, you know, where it's like we're in competition with each other and there's resentment and envy. And I tend to be really wary of that. And I think, and it's easy to see that actually on Twitter and Instagram and so forth. And unfortunately, because of the pandemic, a lot of the activism is happening, the life of activism, you see it happening online as offline. When you see it offline, it's much messier, much more nuanced, and you do see people banding together. I think, you know, the way I define Asian American identity, I said it was like a tenuous alliance of different ethnicities, different nationalities, and it's like, and I don't see, I see the Asian American racial condition and identity to be very porous. And I don't, when I talk about Asian American identity, I don't think I could just talk about being Asian. I have, you know, for me, what's more interesting is the relationship between identities rather than just talking about the identity itself. Especially if you think about the way Asian American identity was formed. Asian American was the term itself, the moniker itself was defined by these activists who were very much inspired by the Black Power movement. And so none of this exists in a vacuum, you know? I mean, as much as Asian America was formed through white supremacy and the immigration laws, and was also formed by the civil rights movement. And therefore, I think it's almost impossible to talk about ethnicities as just one. And it's also, there in allyships have to be created. And as I said, later, you know, towards the end of the book, I said, Lorraine O'Grady, I quoted the artist, fabulous artist, Lorraine O'Grady, who said, in the future, white supremacy will not need white people. And that really scared the shit out of me. And I think, like, you know, I think there was a lot of conflict. I think I felt very ambivalent writing the book because it's not, you know, I always thought people assume that Asian American identity is a non-urgent subject. You know, it's like, it's sort of anemic. It's sort of, you know, there's a kind of not the same kind of urgency, right? When you're writing about the Asian American condition. But when I heard that, I felt this like, real need and urgency to finish this book, and I can't really articulate what it was about that quote that really shook me, but it did, and I was like, I need to address it by writing this book.
I mean, absolutely. I think you know, the real issue underlying a lot of this, right, is Ishmael Reed put it as, you know, when he talked about white supremacy, he said a dying mule kicks the hardest, right? Mm-hmm. The conditions that produced this long history of white supremacy are falling apart, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why we feel it so intensely. Mm-hmm. But also that means that all these other, you know, racial positions are getting renegotiated and re-understood. And the question is, do they then reproduce, you know, white supremacy without white people, right?
I think racial identities are being renegotiated right now. And I don't think Asian Americans are really in control of, or they were not always in control of their own narratives. Mm-hmm. Or, and their kind of the parameters of what Asian American identity was always defined for us by white supremacy. And I was like, we need to renegotiate it ourselves. We need to take responsibility. And either both as victims and perpetrators of white supremacy.
Well, and I think that, you know, the last moment when this happened, right, was when the term was created. And the term, if you look at the movements that produced it, they were solidarity movements first, right? They were solidarity movements that turned into figuring out, well, what are we then, right? What is our position? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think you might have mentioned, you know, the answer to that might not be, I think you said this in an interview maybe with Franny Choi, that the answer to this might not be Asian American anymore. That might not be the term. But we need to figure out
something else.
Yeah.
But that's what we are right now, and it has to be.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, it just has, I was going to say, it has to be addressed.
Yeah. There's a number of questions here, and I should say, and if you're sort of seeing them, that the depth of gratitude people have to you for writing this book and how deeply it impacted people is sort of through all these questions. So I'm going to try to grab a couple of them. There's one here about the way that you balance different threads of this book. Someone says, Cathy, I have to thank you from the bottom of my heart for writing this book. It deeply touched me, and I use what I learned from you in the artwork I create today. I'm so impressed by the many entry points used to explore Asian American identity through your own memories, the stand-up of Richard Pryor, the life and work of Teresa Hakyung Cha as some examples. How do you choose these threads and keep them balanced? And I know you talk about having to find a form in which you could express these ideas, right? Going from poetry, learning from stand-up, and moving to what you call this modular essay, which sometimes looks like a very simple form, but when you look at what you're doing and all these things you're putting together, it's quite complicated. Do you want to talk about how you chose those things, kept them balanced, and found a form for that?
It was through a lot of sleepless nights, a lot of anguish and pain and stress, and making my husband read multiple drafts, and you know, that's how I did it. It was not fun. I think like the organization of the book is where my background as a poet has been key to working on this book. I'll say that, like, if you read my poetry, Engine Empire and Dance Dance Revolution, or even my first book, Translating Mom, I've always been a poet who's been very restless. Like, I've always played with genre. Like, whether it's narrative genre, like, drawing in science fiction and poetry, or using prose or different dialects and so forth. I like to kind of use them on. That's and one of my influences was Teresa Hakyung Cha in the book. So my approach to the essay was the same. It was like, I'm not gonna just do memoir. I'm not gonna write as a memoirist. I'm gonna also put on my critic's hat, on my historian's hat, and my asshole's hat. You know, I just like, I wanted to kind of embody as many different identities as possible. So when I was writing about reckoning, thinking about reckoning with Asian American, I was also thinking I had to do it from many different positions as a woman, as was once a girl, as a poet, as a former artist, as a citizen of this country, as a woman of color, as a mother, as a daughter, and I wanted to inhabit as many roles as possible in writing this book, and therefore, it was very important for me to have all these different entry points. What was also very important for me, I've gotten some flack for this book. People are like, why is this book so digressive? Or it's like, I don't understand why, you know, it wasn't like this historical, overarching historical perspective on Asian America, and why she wrote about like her friendship. And, you know, like why she spent so much time writing about a friendship in college. And I was like, for me to write a book about the Asian American condition, I had to be as viscerally subjective as possible, as personal as possible. It was like, in the subtitle it says An Asian American Reckoning, and it was like, I really wanted it to be as singular as possible. And I think in that way, and I think that was also why it reached out to people. I think a lot of people say, I think there's been a lot of terms thrown around about like the psychological condition of it being Asian American, that you're invisible or you're in between or you're not belonging or you're not represented. And when those terms get used so many times, they just get tired, And like, this is what, as a poet, like I wanted to be like, okay, I want to be as specific as I can getting, I just want to really embody being in an invisible body, really write what it's like to be in my body in this country, and the physiological reactions of alienation, estrangement, and so forth. So and I think writing in that sort of non-linear way and writing with these different passages really helped with that. And I didn't with the essays, I didn't write from beginning to end by any means. It's almost like each prose passage was like a stanza. Each paragraph was a stanza that I was kind of connecting together almost associatively, maybe almost more musically, or like through certain strands of ideas, and I also wanted the essays to interconnect, so I'll start one idea, drop it, pick it up in the next essay, because I wanted to have that kind of continuity.
No, that was really great. I should say, I'm trying to sort of pull together some of these questions on the side here, because we have so many that people want to hear. And you actually answered several of them in a row. I want to just sort of thank the person who's asking about whether you consider minor films an autobiography, which I think you started to address. Mm-hmm. There's a question about what it's like for a poet to work so deeply in prose, referencing the chapter Bad English, which I should say that chapter is really, really moving to me. Your line in there, my method of othering English is to eat English before it eats me, right? I just kind of opened up the whole book to me. And I also want to thank you, by the way, because you wrote about Teresa Cha, as a critic, but as a poet writing as a critic, I think you're able to do something that nobody else writing about Cha has done, and it was really powerful. And I recommend that chapter to anybody, especially and I hope that folks here know more about Teresa Cha. Well, let me actually then pick up on a question here about. This is about the relationship between minor feelings and gender, right? So this is absolutely, in talking about Asian Americanness, is absolutely an intersectional, I think, question about gender throughout, and very much so in your discussing this lineage of writers like Cha and Myung-Mi Kim that you respond to when you talk about your relationship to other Asian Americanists. So do you want to talk about the relationship between minor feelings and gender?
As a gender?
So, the relationship between minor feelings and gender.
Oh, that's a very good question.
It's very wide open.
It's quite wide open. I think that, I guess like when, I think minor feelings is very much gendered in terms of the way women in general, I would say women are their interior life, once it's actually outwardly expressed, is often dismissed or not acknowledged or not considered legitimate in any kind of way. I think that's very much a female experience as well. I think it's even doubly so as an Asian American woman. And there was a lot more that I could have written about in terms of Asian American being Asian American and gender and sexuality. I think that is still, many poets and scholars have written about it, but I still think it needs to be tapped even deeper. I have to say, it's like, it's all the kind of emotions that I felt, you know, as an Asian American woman. I mean, I think this is, it's a very good question, and I think I have to sit up, think about it.
Well, can I actually, if I just ask you to frame it in terms of, I don't know if you want to talk more about what Teresa Chau's work has meant to you, or what the work of someone like Myung-Mi Kim, who writers who very deliberately through their form rejected a lot of the limiting ways that people read them strictly through the lens of ideas about race and gender, right? But were nonetheless deeply concerned with those issues. So I don't know if you think in writing about them, you're thinking consciously about a lineage or not, but if you can talk about one of those, right?
Yeah, I was definitely creating, Jenny Zhang said something really great where she's like, the canon is being created now in relation to Asian American writing. And I definitely agree with that. And what I wanted to do was, with the book, I think usually when you read a lot of Asian American novels in particular, it's usually related to family, intergenerational trauma, and one's relationship with one's mother, father, and so forth, which is absolutely necessary. But I wanted to do something a little bit different and have a different idea of what family was. I was thinking about artistic family, creative families. I wanted to write about, and also this, you know, Minor Feelings is also a portrait of an artist, you know. It's a portrait of an, it's my portrait of an artist, but it's also a portrait of artists as Teresa Hakim Cha, but it's also a portrait of an artist of what I went through to become the writer that I am today. And I think it's very important to kind of acknowledge the friendships that you had and the women that I was influenced by, like Myung-Mi Kim and Teresa Hakim Cha, and a number of other writers who I list there. A lot of them I purposely wrote mentioned women of color, because I just think, I write about this in this book, but when we talk, you know, artistic friendships are mythologized all the time. And they always tend to be male or white, and women of color are just not acknowledged at all. And so for me, it was really, really important to center that and to prioritize that as much as possible, which is why such a large part of the book is about friendship. And it was also for me a way of decentering whiteness, you know. And I'm like, okay, yes, Asian American is so much defined by white supremacy, but the way I really came of age as a writer wasn't because I read a lot of Wallace Stevens. It was because of these friendships I had. It was because of Myung-Mi Kim and Teresa Hakim Cha. And it was really, really, really important for me to enunciate and amplify that as much as possible.
Actually, if I can expand on that a little bit, because when you're asked to have that lineage, right, I think usually the expectation is, will you fill that in with people who look like you, right? But I know that your influences and your relationships with other writers of color or other women writers are also really important. And I need to quickly name drop our mutual friend Evie Shockley.
Mm-hmm.
I just taught her book this week and was talking to her about you, actually. So I was wondering if you want to talk about some other writers you see in that lineage who aren't necessarily Asian American, or in whether in a lineage or in the network of friendships that sustained you as a writer.
Oh, that's a great question. I mean, I would say Evie Shockley is one of them. She's amazing. If all of you are not familiar with Evie Shockley, Shockley's poetry and criticism, I recommend that you go out and get her work. She's absolutely brilliant. And, you know, her, I would say she's really amazing. You know, this is my opportunity to plug a friend's work. Sedil Shah's This Is One Way to Dance, like she's someone who whose work I really admire and someone who I connect to. Monica Yoon is a poet who's absolutely fucking brilliant. Don Lundy Martin. I mean, a lot of them are just, a lot of the people who I really connect with are, you know, I mean, I come from the poetry world, so it's a lot of poets of color, women poets of color, who are doing really, really interesting, difficult, radical work, and who are just really kick-ass, and I feel blessed. I feel really blessed to have these friendships, and I think, like, you know, also since, and also not just women, Rick Barrett, Galleons, whose book about Galleons is absolutely fantastic, Douglas Kearney. I mean, I now like Ronaldo Wilson. I could go on. Just can you go on a litany of writers? But I think this is a really, I don't know. I mean, I feel so much. Feel so much existential despair of what this future is, what the future is going to be. But when I think about just the sheer amount of talent that's coming from voices that were previously ignored, I'm absolutely I'm in awe, you know, and I feel blessed that I'm writing at this period, at this time where there is this real camaraderie. I've said this, Somal Sharif is another poet who wrote Look. I remember when she was doing a book launch, I think it was 2017 or 18, I was saying that like it was a renaissance, you know, and I think it is still a renaissance of Black writers, Indigenous writers, Latinx writers, Muslim writers, Asian American writers. Yeah, I mean, they're all intersected, you know. And I just hope, I think it's going to grow. And I hope, you know, I know it will grow.
Absolutely, and I should say, teaching right now in the midst of this, and seeing, you know, how students are responding, not just to the kind of political issues that sometimes it was harder to get them to pay attention to in the past, but the way they connect that with really nuanced readings of poetry and the imagination is really remarkable. So I think that there's another wave of this coming, but I also think that it's important to acknowledge, right, just as we said, you know, the idea of Asian America as a category was built in solidarity, right? The creative possibilities that you're talking about, you know, they're not just Asian American, they are relational in that way.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how much time we have. I know I want to ask that there's a couple other questions. There's a question I want to ask, which I was too frightened to ask myself, so it's here, so I'm going to ask it. I'm going to give you a chance to turn away from it if you don't want. So there's a question about your mother and writing about your mother. And then there's also a question about indebtedness. And I don't know whether the ending of this and talking about indebtedness and this is the weight, do you have any questions? Do you have any thoughts about how Asian Americans can imagine liberation while also weighing this condition of indebtedness, right, is there? And then also earlier, this question of way you kind of step around writing more intensely about your mother and whether that's something that is waiting for you as a task or a writer, or that's something that you want to think
about. That's my next book. Yeah, but I've always shied away from writing about my mother, and just because if it's like, oh my God, every Asian American writer has written about their mother, you know, and it's like, and all writers go through a mother phase. Usually the first book is about their mother and then they write about other things. And it's always been sort of like a kryptonite. Like I don't like to go there. Really, I don't know how to approach the subject of motherhood, of my mother. And I also thought with that book, it wasn't appropriate to write about my mom because it was like I said in the book, she would just take over. She would take over minor feelings. And it was more about questions of race and having scores to settle with, as I said, with the way we've been scripted, and also scores to settle with this country. And but I am thinking about writing about my mother, but in a way, I'm I don't want to do it in a memoiristic way. And I'm, this is where I'm trying to figure it out. I want to write it in a way that's, you know, after reading, writing this book, I want to like, there's a part of me that wants to go back to my really weird avant-garde roots as a poet. You know, I was like, okay, that was me. Minor Feelings was me being very direct. Now let's go back to me being weird. I'm trying to figure out a way to approach the subject in a way that feels strange and fresh and urgent to me. And I think part of that is also, I think I've also, you know, I've been talking to my mother, but I've also been talking to other people from Calden and so forth, and their relationships with their toxic mothers. And it's been very eye-opening. And I think right now what I'm trying to do is just listen. You know, I think Minor Feelings is very much about me, and it was also me amplifying other voices, but it was more through works of literature and artwork and memories, of course. And I'm more interested in now actually listening to living stories and seeing what I can do with that. So that's the question of being a mom. What was the first question? I think we're also out of town time, I think. Or I don't know if I have time to answer the first part of the question.
Yeah, we have just a little bit of time left, so.
What was the first part of the question again?
The question was about, we were talking at the end of the, in the last essay about indebtedness, right?
Oh.
I was particularly challenged by how you end discussing the condition of indebtedness. It just feels heavy because the work of activists and our ancestors shouldn't have had to happen in the first place. Do you have thoughts about how Asian Americans can imagine liberation while also weighing this condition of indebtedness?
Weighing this condition of indebtedness. Okay, I'm not sure if I'm quite, that's a very good question. I mean, very lot of, I think the whole book is in a way dealing with a question of debt, you know, and I think there is good debt and bad debt, you know. There is a kind of debt that I think, I don't even know if it's all Asian Americans. I mean, I'd be curious. Actually, I would like to ask that question to you as a fourth generation Japanese American. And I wonder if this question of indebtedness is also particular for me being a second generation Korean American, because Korean Americans are so obsessed with debt, you know, and like, and you know, carrying on the legacy of their parents. And, you know, part of that debt is, you know, never, you know, as immigrants, you never look back. You only look forward. But by looking forward, you're like, you know, your children are an investment. And I also, you know, your children are treated as an investment for coming here. And that's a real kind of psychological weight. That's also capitalist too. And I wonder like how much of it is, you know, this kind of colonized idea of the American dream, where we're kind of fed this idea that once you come here, you should be grateful because you've been given this opportunity and you can't complain and you don't ask for handouts or anything like that. And also how much is maybe quite frankly cultural as well. Maybe that is also something that does come from where our parents' culture. I can maybe say that is the case maybe with Koreans, you know. But I grew up in the you know, in the etiquette, like in the culture of debt, you know, that there's always something that are that you owe, you know. And then there's also, of course, debt, accumulated debt and so forth. But then there's also the kind of debt that you do owe to history and to all the activists who have made it possible for you. And you have to remember, and you have to also be held accountable for that as well. So I think that was like the, I don't know, I was trying to kind of weigh those options. I mean, these are also just questions. I wrote this book, I specifically wrote essays because I wanted to, I had these questions that I wanted to answer, you know, that, and, I think instead of excavating are digging for the truth, I just also ended up with more questions. But I'm also hoping that through this book, I opened up space for readers to address that question, answer it for themselves.
So. Well, I think, I mean, you know, what I find really powerful about this book, and also, you know, maddening at times, right, is that you know, find the language to work through all these kind of sort of encrusted ideas about Asian Americanness that, you know, get impatient with, frankly, right? Like, why do I have to deal with this, right? Or, you know, why everybody wants me to write about my mother, right? How do you write about your mother? When, you know, how do you deal with that? When you say, well, actually, maybe I do want to write about my mother, but I can't write about my mother because everybody wants me to write about my mother, right? Mm-hmm. That sense of debt, I think that second generation immigrant kid's sense of debt, right? So much of it is encrusted with the narratives of, you know, the American dream, nationalist narratives about immigration that don't get to what those relations are. For me, I always go back to Fred Moten's work on debt, Stefano Harney, where he talks about, you know, maybe bad debt is what we want, right? It's actually only when you think about debt in strictly economic terms that we want debts to cancel out. We want to be in a condition of indebtedness to each other all the time because that's how we are in meaningful relation to each other, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe we want to be that source of bad debt because to pay off, you know, I was telling students, like, well, if you imagine paying off all your debts to your parents, what is it if you pay off all your debts to your parents? That's saying fuck you to your parents that I don't want to deal with you anymore, right? Mm-hmm. We need to have that. But I mean, I think, again, what I think is really so fantastic to me about this book and why, you know, I think everybody I know who reads it, loves it sometimes and wants to throw it against the wall sometimes, you face up to these things that we don't know how to talk about, right? So I think that in this book, you kind of liberate the language to ask some questions that you couldn't ask before. Mm-hmm. So I hope that is also true when you, if you choose to find time to write about your mother, because I'm very excited to hear about that.
I don't know if I'll be writing about my mother, maybe mother. You were going to say.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, we're a couple minutes over, but I know that we're about to end. And I know there's some brilliant questions here we didn't get to or we skimmed over. Thank you so much for those questions. Is there anything more you wanted to?
Now I'm just like looking at the Q&A quickly right now. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I have to say, I really appreciated what you're saying about debt and Fred Moten's Undercommons is a book that was also very an inspiration. One of the many, many, many inspirations for Minor Feelings and me thinking about debt. You know, talk a little bit less about financial debt or capitalist debt. The way he does, but of course it's all part of the immigrant story, right? It's all monetized too. It's like cultural and monetized, and it's like, yeah, why extricate yourself from that? Just be in debt, you know, and maybe only that way we can liberate ourselves. But thank you, Vince. Thank you so much for your really, really thoughtful questions. It was really delightful to be in doing this Zoom conversation with you. And I'm also really happy that I didn't glitch out or something, because that tends to happen. but I really, this was really lovely. And I hope, and I'm sorry I couldn't answer all your questions. I hope maybe there'll be another opportunity where I can. Maybe in person somewhere. Ooh. In another universe.
One day you'll get to go.
2025.
if there's still a country.
We'll see. If there's still a country, yeah. Oh.
Well, on that hopeful note, thank you so much, Cathy and Vince. And that was such an interesting and important conversation. And I'm so grateful for both of you taking the time to be here tonight. If you attendees are interested in reading a little bit more, Minor Feelings is available as an ebook and an audiobook on the library's website. That's spl.org. And you can also order it for delivery or curbside pickup through our partners on this event, Elliott Bay Book Company, and their website is elliottbaybook.com. And actually, a side note, Isabel Wilkerson, who you mentioned earlier, the author of Cast, is actually going to be doing an event with Elliott Bay Book Company and I believe the Northwest African American Museum, and that will take place on August 7th. So save the date for that. I think she's spoken in Seattle before and she's a wonderful speaker. So thanks again to our sponsors, the Seattle Public Library Foundation, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, Seattle City of Literature, and the Seattle Times. And thanks to all of you for joining us tonight, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you. Thank you so much.